So thank you everybody for coming along today. I'm not going to do much of an introduction except to say we're delighted that Clare Twomey is joining us today. One of the things I'm often asked, I'm director of research around this place, and people are often asking me how they can essentially turn their life as an artist or creator or maker of things into something that counts or makes sense in a university context as research. And we have many people doing that in lots of different ways. And one of our most shining examples of that is clearly Clare Twomey. So I invited her along to talk about how she makes that work. That's all I'm going to say.
Brilliant.
That makes sense? That line up with what you think you're going to be talking about?
Yeah.
So
thank you,
Clare.
And I'll take questions at the end to see whether I live up to David's review of that situation. So we shall see. So it is your lunchtime, so I shall try and speed over things lightly and try to, yeah, it's a long journey. Maybe that's a good starting point, that it's a long journey. So the first slide I've decided to show you is probably the thing that you fear most about research, or I could be just placing that in front of you as one of my things that I've become accustomed to seeing, which is the research applications. And the reason I'm showing you this one, and there's a big difference here, this says AHRB, which means that I've been a researcher for quite some time, because it's now called the AHRC, where you can get large grants for research that allow you to come to brilliant institutes like this, with research centres which are couldn't be as fantastic as CREAM. But the reason I'm showing you this is the start of my journey into what I see as really understanding what research as an artist is. So when I went to art college and I did ceramics and I got my BA, and then I went on to my MA at the Royal College and I got my MA there, I had no idea that 20 years later I would be an artist researcher. And it was probably about 6-7 years ago where I realised those landscapes had completely merged. So at this point, I'd been teaching for 5 years at different art colleges around the country as an income, and also because I could do it really well. I enjoyed doing it. It was about clay, it was about sharing skills, it was about growing the discipline in which I worked. And at that point, there was huge amounts of growth within ceramics and a very strong culture. So I was actually working for another institute, Farnham, which they've renamed into something else. But it had a very strong... University of the Creative UCA. Arts. I usually manage to misplace that one. So I was there before the renaming, and it was a great department, and it started to show me, they were just starting a research culture, and I got a little bit of research funding to send some work to exhibitions. And at that point, I think I saw research as this way to get my work to move around the world, and it was kind of adjacent to me being an artist. So I was working half the week in academia and half the week in my studio making stuff, and then it was brilliant because the university there would pay for it to go around halfway around the world. And I thought, oh, brilliant, I like research. And then I filled in this form. And this form was a research fellowship for 3 years here at the University of Westminster. And the reason that I could do it here was that because there was a strong research centre here, that I could say, I need to shift institute to be able to do research really, really well. And from that point, I remember the very first day being a research fellow here, going into my studio, exactly the same as I did as an artist, sitting there going, right, what do I do as a researcher that I don't do as an artist already? Because my experience at that point was that research paid for stuff to go around the world, and I just got on with it in the rest of my week. The most fundamental point for me was when I realised that research enabled me to ask questions and to ask questions of people I would never have dared to ask questions of previously, to question theories that I would previously as an artist just gone along with or flowed with, or somehow this research grant, the early years grant, allowed me to take on that role of investigating, researching, asking questions, making assessments about where are we, that I can ask these questions. And I don't think as an artist I didn't have these questions before, and it didn't take over my practice in a way that I was uncomfortable with. But these are a couple of examples. So within the first year of the grant, I formed this group, 6040, and we were a group of artists who worked in what was formerly known as the applied arts, and we'd meet at private views looking at work, being artists, and going, yeah, but this isn't happening. Why isn't this happening? Where's this critical debate about this? So we had formed a collective called 6040, and this collective ran well beyond my research projects. And we wrote a manifesto, which was very good, took us 6 months. And I was the only one in a formal research project. So the other artists were seeing this as something exciting and beneficial. So it allowed me to feel, actually, I've got a right. I need to put this group together so we can investigate in real terms, what is the critical landscape we're working in? What is practice now? Why do we feel restless about it? So rather than waiting for other people to give us those answers, as a researcher, suddenly I picked up this thing that gave me time, and I felt some kind of authority to go beyond my role as what I saw an artist was. This is like 15 years ago. So this group rolled on for about 8 years. We curated a regular commissioning spot at Siobhan Davies for 6 years. But also, it allowed me to publish this newspaper. And this newspaper was part of, it's a one-off, useful newspaper, but it allowed me, again, to ask questions outside of where I thought I practiced as an artist. So I asked Cornelia Parker, who was in a making group, an artist group that I had a relationship with. Cornelia Parker, I said, who do you want to talk to about practice? She chose Ron Arid. That was hysterical. Then Keith Harrison chose Richard Wentworth. Siobhan Davies chose Edmund Duval. And Paul Williams, the architect, chose Hans Stoffer. So there are these relationships. Did that feel like research? Well, it felt like I was asking the questions I needed to ask so I could place my artistic practice in a place where it was going to do more than I previously thought it could do. So suddenly, if we look at my practice as an artist, I'm asking questions of it that aren't about the continuation of work, but it's why the continuation of work. Probably questions we all ask ourselves in studios about creative practice, of the methods to move forward. And this research grant helped me to understand that I was allowed to ask those questions and they would be very important to my practice. So I wrote my first published essay in this book during that grant, and this week it's just been republished in this lovely ceramics reader, which apparently you could pick up at the Tate Britain. Sort of tweaked on that yesterday. So it wasn't a waste of time writing that 10 years ago. They republished it. But it did allow me to take on bigger, more ambitious projects, because I was asking bigger, more ambitious questions about the context I was working in. And I was approaching people that I may have felt I wouldn't be able to ask these questions of. But as a researcher, I could co-curate an exhibition at Middlesbrough Institute of Modern Art where I got to be an artist. This is my work. I built a 9-metre tall pile of beautiful rubble from Stoke-on-Trent that is functional, beautiful things that are come out of ceramic industry. But as part of that, I got to ask questions of my peers. So this is the brilliant Linda Sorman, Keith Harrison and Neil Brownsword. These artists were part of my group and they had questions. So I could go to them and I could say, Linda, who works in an American context, I could say to her, you know, how come you've never built something really, really big? And she's going, well, because I can't fund it, because there's nobody who's going to keep it. And again, this is all about time. So we have to move back and understand this is 10 years ago. And so for her, the biggest challenge of this commission was to make something in a gallery that was temporary, but a very, very large work. For Keith Harrison, who makes lots of works that are ephemeral, the challenge and the curation of that was to say, can we keep something that's live for 3 months in this gallery? And even though through this research, I understood that there was lots of other live activities going on in other areas of art practice, why weren't they happening in clay? Why weren't they happening within the boundaries of craft? So I got to be persuasive. I got to say, we must do this. Then we got to write another very nice book. And from there, I brought in the critical theorists that I felt should be talking about the things we need to talk about. So for me, what research did, it enabled me, and we're all very different, so you might have this in your practice already. You might go knocking on doors. You might be going, why aren't you doing this? I did need research to do that, and I needed to do the background work, I needed to do the reading, I needed to do the surveys, I needed to understand what was missing, to understand fundamentally why has nobody asked these questions. So I'm just going to hop back for a moment. So I suppose that part of this dialogue between being an artist and being a researcher is, do you stop making work? Do you stop being an artist? For me, it kind of had this lovely nudge, which meant I could be more of an artist in the place I wanted to find out more about more easily through research. So it was a really huge enabler, which allows me then to go to this. And it is tiny. You're not going to be able to read it. It's the next big AHRC bid. So that we took on in the Ceramics Research Centre inside of CREAM here at the university. So in this time of kind of, the grant was for 3 years, it was about another 2 years before we could figure out to write something that made sense around the practice that I had as an artist and the work I was making. What that brought to galleries, what research brings to galleries in the sense of looking at critically why things haven't happened, how they can happen, and how you can be at the centre of enabling that kind of artist practice which is questioning everything that's happened before. So once we knew some of these things, and Christy Brown knew more about her practice and where the Ceramics Research Centre was going, Edmund Duval was undertaking a lot of the practice he was taking within museums, we wrote up this bid. So this new HRC bid probably took about a year, year and a half to write. And it said we were going to produce the first critical overview of the relationship between contemporary ceramics and museum culture, investigate and contextualize both the history and curatorial practice in exhibitions of contemporary ceramics. And so it goes on. These are all the things we thought were missing. And they weren't just missing from this big amorphous landscape. They were things we were missing in our practice. There were things as artists we didn't see happening. We couldn't understand why. Why aren't we talking about this? Why aren't we doing this? And I think it was from the first fellowship that I undertook. I think the first 3 months were so shocking. I thought everybody in the world was doing what I was doing and I was just another one. Then I realised there are only 4 people in the world really doing stuff similar to me in the same same context. So it was just the research was really revealing, and that's kind of what happened with this project also, this large 3-year project funded by the AHRC. In the first project I worked on my own. I got on with all of these things, obviously not completely on my own because I had all these brilliant relationships and we made all this stuff happen with the partners. But here we've got 3 researchers, and so we're putting our minds together. And this research project felt quite different. It felt like our collective voice was very important. So as an artist, if you're working in a studio in isolation, but you want to come together on something, you want to grow or you feel like you've got like minds, so you think, I want to get those together. That's what I experienced on ceramics in the expanded field. There was, when I would drop something, somebody else would pick it up. When they couldn't see it, I would grab it. And there was this lovely, lovely relationship of the teamwork, of seeing how big the picture of artists working in with museums with clay was, something that hadn't been looked at, that had so much potential and still grows on. We got to design a very lovely website through this project, so that was fun. On this project, we got to commission, I think we have 15 essays to contribute to this project. So people we adore from all over the world, we say, what do you think about this? Write us an essay. And all of that, it is the essay, it is the thoughts, but also it's your relationships with those people, your art practice with those people, why you care about the same things, why they might be important. Then, of course, we've got PhD research. And so alongside of this, continually, I'm learning more about PhD research, learning how to help the students with PhD research. So there is learning, there is grant writing, there is being organised enough to be able to send a brief to a website designer and say, that's what we want it to look like. But all of those things are enabling a sense of growth where it's worthwhile. Inside of this project, and I'm going to try and stop speaking quite soon, inside of this project, these are the artworks that I made. So the artworks about museums, identity inside museums, critiques of the functions of the museum. I won't talk too much about them. They look like art, and a lot of people were involved. This piece was in the States, in the Nelson Atkins Museum. It was a large exchange project. Here is another piece, Plymouth porcelain. This happened during the project, and again, the evidence from this has gone into further research. And if you're an artist in a studio, you would say, that piece that I made helped to influence my thinking here. It's exactly the same in research. Me at a bench with my hand in alginate talking to this lovely lady about how I'm not going to destroy the beautiful object she's given me to cast, that's research. We did it. Again, this is another piece that involved lots of people. 1,000 people, men, telling us their thoughts on how they'd like to be remembered. This is the work. And in this project, there were 4 of us working. Christy Brown was also one of the artists. Nicholas Rena, who has nothing to do with research or any institutes. So research doesn't isolate you. I believe it enables, but this is a piece from the Foundling Museum that was made right at the end of this large grant, and it really helped me to understand my role on the project about how museums can, through the work of artists, really understand their contemporary life as well as their historic life. And I'm not going to talk in too much detail about it because we haven't got that much time, but these cups and saucers were set up at the Foundling Museum, and the Foundling Museum is where mothers exchanged their children so they could take their firstborn child, give it to the Foundling Hospital, which was set up in 1718, I can't remember, but quite when there was no care for children at all, apart from the community nurse who had a death rate of 9 out of 10 babies given to her. So mothers would bring their children. Mothers generally couldn't write, so they left tokens that meant they could come back and describe that token and receive their child back if their circumstances changed for these unwanted babies. So here we made an exchange for 3 months where people could come to the museum, and there were cups and saucers. This is just the back of the cups. And if you took a cup that said, clean the whole house for your mum, and you were willing to take that cup and do a good thing, then in exchange for that, you could keep the cup. The saucer would remain, very much like the mother and daughter, mother and child would always be separate from this relationship with the hospital. Then through this work, we could bring a contemporary language about cup and saucer, a whole thing becoming a separated thing, but both still functioning in different ways. This is the final work of this project. This is a piece titled Piece by Piece, and it was actually made for a Canadian museum in the Gardner Museum, and it was a live performance for 3 months, and it references the making of the beautiful Meissen pieces that are in their collection. And this performance happened for 3 months, a level above that in the museum. So there's great, great discussions about how we move through spaces, how we acknowledge spaces, how we acknowledge histories, and the performative act of making within a place that was all about things that were made was a very exciting project to undertake. So that's all inside that large research project, all of those artworks, all of that being an artist, being a researcher, all of these landscapes merged. Then at the end of it, you have to do a big conference, which is fantastic. And that's when you get to invite Theaster Gates and Simon Groom to come and have a conversation and a dialogue and give a keynote. So as a researcher, I was able to say, okay, let's contact Theaster Gates. As an artist in a studio, I may not have done that. So I kind of feel like there's so much empowerment that has come, or maybe it's just bravery in other forms, to say, actually, you're really important. If you talk here to all these other people, then all these bridges are going to be built, because Theaster Gates started off as a potter. And the reason he was really, really willing to do this, because one of our researchers, Julian Stair, was his absolute hero. So it was a lovely moment when the great Theaster Gates met Julian Stair and both of their knees went weak. It was fantastic. Wrote a book. It's going very well. Lots of people love it. There's a lovely review. There's all kinds of lovely reviews out of there. So Christy Brown, Julian Stair, and myself got to ask 20 people to write their thoughts down and to publish it with Routledge, which was great. And then Tom, who's helped put these wonderful things together, these beautiful ref books, this is kind of how it looks sometimes. So you work for 5 years as a researcher, you make lots of artwork. This is important for us here as a research centre, to value what we do, to understand how it makes a difference in the world. So this is I had 4 ref books, which are very lovely things, but they catalogue the artwork so clearly. I had to write down, and then lots of people helped me write it better, what the artwork did, why it was made, who helped make it, what were the methods of making, the things we do day to day in a studio as an artist, but when we catalogue them and understand that in greater detail, there are so many layers and mechanisms of usefulness within that. So this is nice. So this piece we're writing about there, but now that's going on to Yale to, and somebody can correct me if I get this wrong, I think it's the British Centre for Art at Yale, but I usually get that title wrong way around somewhere. But so this work and some of the knowledge that was put together to write this ref submission, to say we've done the research, we know what it is, we know how it functions in the world, and we know why it's made a difference, has helped Yale, by looking at that, say, yeah, we should have this artwork. And now they're putting another book together about it and lots of other clay things. These are the other artworks. Some of them I've talked about, some of them I haven't, that form my artistic practice, but form my relationship with research, and have helped form a great deal of my practice growing. Some of you might know that these are the things that haven't been into the ref, which will go in. So this is 10,000 hours, a relationship of making, which is at York Art Gallery. Lots of nice things. Some of them happened at Westminster. Worked on a project with the Holocaust Memorial Day Trust, which isn't in a museum, which has helped me understand more about public practice, which is really, really interesting. And this is the William Morris project that just happened this summer, which is leading on to another piece, at the Bronte, which opens up in a month's time, where we're rewriting Wuthering Heights with the help of about 12,000 people. But I shall let this little time lapse play, hopefully. So that's the end of my talk, with hopefully this time lapse of change of us over 3 months with 70 apprentices from the public painting this beautiful Morris completely gold from one end to the other. So that's research in some way. So that's my jolly ride through research and the benefits. I could tell you the hard work on writing forms, but you know, you don't look back at this body of work. I don't look back at this body of work and think, oh, I hated writing that form. Because I'm also part of a great team of people here who can help when I need help. And also being part of CREAM is just brilliant, just to have this relationship with so many other brilliant researchers. It's so valuable. Okay, evangelical artist researcher finished speaking. do we do questions now, David?
Yes, thank you, Clare. I wrote down and tweeted, research doesn't isolate you, I believe it enables, which was nice.
I live with that.
Good. Anybody, questions? I can start off if you like. There's that thing where, so you're showing that and you say in that sweet voice, sort of, that's research in some way.
Yes.
I think that in some way points to that sort of question which lots of people have about, okay, so you made a thing, and then, like, what is the bit that then means that that becomes research or doesn't become research? Like, one question that people say is, do I have to write about it? Is it? And you've talked about some cases of you having to write things down. And I know you don't love writing things down, do you? Mm. Writing isn't your favourite thing, is that right?
It's a forcible act.
And is it in the writing that you've had to do writing in order to turn it into research, or is there a way in which some of this is research without it being writing? What's the bit about...
I think that one of the most interesting things that came out of those beautiful ref books I showed you was evidencing. So not holding things up in midair and going, oh yeah, of course that happened, and I'll walk through that. It's about evidencing things. So having 70 apprentices from the public, we've got the museum records of who turned up and short sentences on why they turned up. So eventually, I will write this up as a case study for research or as part of an ongoing research bid. But there are things here where I can prove that things happened. I can prove that you didn't have to have painted watercolours for 40 years to turn up to the William Morris Gallery to start understanding what an exchange of skills was. That existed within the artwork. And we've got this to say it's truly there. We've got, because of the wonderful things and the constructs of museums, we've got all the records of people who attended. And in that, they write a little sentence about why they attended. So I suppose part of it is being knowing about why it's important. And it's also being in the world and a hunch not being enough to move you forward. So I suppose in a lot of the artworks I do, there's a lots of evidencing of practice, which is not in words, it's in action form, but I capture it, which is important.
That capturing is key, isn't it? And it would vary from case to case, wouldn't it? But in that case, you had the foresight, as it were, to capture mere sentences. You just got them to write down a sentence. And I bet at the end of it, you think, oh, thank God we did that, because then you've got those different bits of sort of supporting evidence that are going to be useful later on. It's one of those things you can so easily overlook, but you need to capture things as part of the process. Mm. That you're going to need later.
And you've got to capture the right thing.
Yeah. Oh. Or just capture lots of things, and some of them will be the right things, and some of them,
that's,
it doesn't
that's
matter.
True. That can
Tom.
I promise you I'll ask you a question.
I'm ready, Tom. I'm ready.
Do you think that these works stand alone as artworks outside of the research process? And if so, how do they do that?
It's a good question. And I think a really, really, really important question. I feel that I was sorely tested on that in the last 2 years, because in a way, the work that I do with museums is And there's a lovely contention about an artist going into a museum, you become a tool for that museum in some ways. You're activating things. You know, we had a lovely discussion in the last part of, or reflective part of our big research project, and it was acknowledgement of a couple of curators going, actually, if I bring an artist in, they can do things that I can't do, so I let them get on with it, so they can be the bad boy in the museum, whatever that might be, or they can be reckless, because the curator can't be because of their responsibilities. So there's part of, I know the kind of sheltered world of the museum, but how dynamic it is as well. So I think that your question was tested in the Holocaust Memorial Day Trust, where I worked without those parameters. I worked on Westminster Bridge, where you're not protected by a lot of other vehicles that will say, we commissioned you, so this is art and we validate it. The Holocaust Memorial Day Trust was a really open proposition. It was a place which didn't have a museum collection to work against, and the artwork was very long and it was very exposed. But what I take from that is that by my contemporaries, by the reporting of it, it was reported as an artwork, not as research. It was reported and reviewed as an artwork, not as research. So I don't know whether there's part of the art world that's moved towards research or acknowledge the languages of research that we can easily say it is. I think I make art. I think what I get out of it is research to make more art. I think I'd find it difficult if the art disappeared, because that's my language, that's what I do. I don't know how to do other kinds of research. And so I mean, I've picked up some of the tools, but so I think that the way, it's interesting because last week I was on a forum, and for the first time ever, which is somewhat surprising, I was referred to as, they always put artists first, but artist scholar, Clare Twomey. And I was like, oh, right, what's that then? Crikey, I didn't realise I got to that point. So I thought that was quite interesting, but I think it was the terminology. But it's quite interesting in that ordering, most people will say artist, and then they might say researcher. And a lot of the time, it's kind of like, 7 years ago, where I thought research was paying for my artwork, I suddenly realised that the two were completely merged. And it was very difficult to talk about my work, not understanding my responsibility to the work that I'm making. Responsibility is when you're working with lots and lots of people's thoughts, not to be frivolous with it, and somehow research helps you to take that forward, or that knowledge forward in a meaningful way. So I think I made a purposeful decision about 6 or 7 years ago to really not see that research was propping up the artworks or the artworks propping up the research. I think they have a really collaborative role. But I think the work is reviewed as art. But maybe that's my perspective or my wants.
It is though, isn't it?
Yeah. It's not worth asking this one because it's the same question, I think. Tell me if it... My question was... would you have done the same things if you were just seeing yourself as an artist? Because you could just be not employed by a university, pursuing a career as an artist. You would get asked to do things like this. You would presumably do things like this. Does it make any difference that they are beset? But that's the same question, I think, isn't it?
No, it's not. It's so profoundly different.
Oh, yeah?
It's
just okay. Similar.
Completely different.
Tell us about the difference, then.
The difference is that if I wasn't a researcher and I wasn't putting my time to really investigating another understanding of future practice in some form or other, then I might be working, and it's a big dilemma, I might be making work that maybe didn't pursue the big questions and dealt with my everyday needs. So it might change the kind of practice I do. And that would have been based on the idea that I might have even been brave enough to come out of the studio and say I'm worth something. So there's this kind of relationship between how do you get out of your studio and start making your work visible to the world. Research allowed me to do that. I mean, before I undertook research, then I was making work, but it gave me a sense of drive for going, oh, it's got a place in the world. Yeah, this is important. And it's through research. So I think I'd make different things, and I might might do lots of different things.
Okay. I don't want to hog the... Good, Michael.
Well, it's an extension on the same thing, because I think if you're a practitioner, there's always the question is, certainly for me, is the pursuit of research, does it in any way compromise your artistic direction or change, which is an extension of David's question.
Yes.
Mm.
And I'm just curious, have you become more the scholar and less the practitioner?
Mm. Can I say that as well? Can I just ask, in the work that you have to do, the research-based work, I'm writing about it, does that ever adversely affect people's appreciation of it, i.e. if you've explained what it is,
mm.
you've then limited people's ability to make their own, to bring their own view to it?
Mm. I think it's a really good question. Maybe this slide will help with this, that as a researcher, I am... the artist researcher, that's me. In the outside world, from me, then this is what happens. People read things like this on websites. Clare Twomey invites visitors to the museum. I'm not telling them there that I really want to know whether 10,000 people will stop their massive journey through the Bronte Museum to stop at this table, take the time to think about, you know, Emily sat down and she wrote this. She wrote it by hand, page by page. So a lot of the things that are in the artwork aren't research. They're empathy. They're why we go to galleries. They're the things we associate and understand. So as much as I've drilled all of my work into research, there's so much human kind of empathy and space within this. So it's very unlikely that I will ever in any of my projects going, come along to this great research project. But actually, it's an accumulative understanding that my practice isn't going like this. It's trying to understand something over a long thread. And some of those artworks might be 5 years apart, the things that start to link up to understand the research practice. It can be really stretched. I might have three different research themes running, and there might be 5 years between those, this whole staggered thing. So I don't... My work is... Yeah, my website.
So would you say the research is giving you a better understanding of the meaning of what you're doing?
Yeah, and it gives me an understanding of how I might change medium, or, you know, we're writing a book. Is that different from pouring water in an unfired cup, which was one of the other pieces? So it kind of helps me to understand the cobweb of my practice. I think it's very difficult, and I think going back to the question about, you know... I personally got a great deal from doing that collaborative 3-year project, Ceramics in the Museum. I would never have done it on my own. I would never have thought, this is the question I've got to ask. It was those three minds coming together going, actually, we can do something, a question that needs to be answered. So, and I think all of arts address this. If you're looking at the Welcome, if you're looking pushes at the Arts Council, if you're looking at any funding bodies to support your practice, there is a political and financial agenda behind what they're funding. And that will change 5 years, 10 years, 2 years. But the important thing for any artist looking at what the Welcome's doing now, for example, is to understand, does my artistic practice fit into that, or am I stretching myself so far that this is a day job?
Well, that's the point.
Yeah.
And
so I think when it becomes a day job, you may not be doing your job as an artist, truly, in some ways. So it's, I don't think that's just about research, though. I think that's about all arts practice. If you're only following funding, then you might feel the bend and the twist in your practice. It might not be comfortable for a while. You might learn some stuff. But I think it's a challenge for everybody in the arts. I think even commercial galleries, you know.
Well, I think, well, it's, on one hand, it's the pursuit of funding, being totally blunt.
Yeah.
That comes into the equation. If you're an artist and that's not been a consideration, it then can be a pull and sometimes a negative pull. And as you said, it can, if you find that challenging, and certainly within the research context, within the university, that whole idea about there is this little pound sign somewhere down the line that you're trying to hit that yeah. enables you to pursue, as you've elegantly described, it can be put off.
But I think it's always worth, even if you spent a year writing a bid, get to the end of it and go, is this the project I really want to do? Because if you don't answer that question there and then, if you get the money, if you do the research, it's going to be an awful schlep if it's not...
it's even before that. It's getting to the end of that year where you're writing and developing the bid. And the momentum, the fuel, the passion that allows you to invest in getting that bid just right. I think there is a focus right at the start as to whether or not this is a good decision, is this a decision that helps my art and so forth, that needs to be made. And it's a dark road up to the point where you complete the bid with no knowledge of whether you'll be successful. That's the point. And you might have been going a slightly different direction along that journey. So it's, I think what I'm driving at here is you've done this several occasions and you've been successful. And have you stopped at some point, I think, considered the extent to which your whole course has changed as a consequence of being in a research unit?
I think that that definitely in the first large fellowship, it was amazing to be in that development. I think in this large project with the three researchers, then everybody needed to own their bit. As soon as we started owning somebody else's bit, that's where the day job arrived. And you're going, hold on, this isn't my area. I don't know anything about it. I don't know if I can bend my practice that far. And I think it's that, it's got to be about integrity, hasn't it? About what you're doing and why it's important to you. Every single artwork I've made, I've only got one dodgy one, which I'm never going to tell anybody about, one, that I kind of feel like, well, actually, I needed to make that work. As much as it's for public benefit, as much as it's about involving participation, things being live that have been still for hundreds of years in museums, the core of it is still me. They're my questions. They're my questions, you know, when I visit museums. So I think, yeah, I think it's a good question, because you can follow research groups that touch you at a distance. Like this, we've been involved in a lovely group at the university with Volker, Chinese medicine, and then we've worked with anthropologists from all over the world, and kind of arrive and kind of going, wow, what's this about? But oh, yeah, I see how that links. But it might be the furthest point I can touch my practice and the furthest point they can touch their practice. You know, the world's an interesting place.
But I think what you've described there is community.
Yeah.
As an artist and like creative, have you found it hard or easy, or like what was your experience on staying focused with the research side of it? Because I find like as a creative, I'm always branching off. Was it easy for you to focus on the research, like not to branch off?
It's interesting because I've shown you some of the works that I've made. But inside of that, I make about three works a year. One of them may be core to the research. The other works are experimental. They're seeing what happens. And they might flow into the research. Maybe that's the bit I should have showed you, not just the finished things. Maybe it's the projects which are brewing, or, you know, somebody emailed me the other day going, I'm doing this feminist project in Walthamstow. Do you want to come and talk? And I'm kind of going, oh, I wonder what that's about. Let's see. So I kind of showed you a really, you know, this is the evidence it works. Mm-hmm. But actually, for every one big project you've seen here, there's two experimental projects kind of running through the studio. I have a studio. It's separate in physical sense from this building. And everything that happens there isn't reported to this building. There's experiments. There's conversations. There's risk. All those things have to happen. There's materials that don't make sense, and you know, so yeah, I don't know if that answers your question really.
Just with the, like, with the writing side of it as well, because I think a lot of artists don't like to write as much, and I don't mind either, but when I write it just goes everywhere, and it's hard to stop yourself and say, like, I'm focusing on this and this is where I'm going with it, and no, don't go, you know, it's that. On the academic side of it, on the research, the writing, how easy it is for artists to...
But it's the same as doing that lovely Arts Council form, you know, to get a small grant, 15 grand. The brilliant thing about writing that, let's forget about all research for a moment, the brilliant thing about writing that form to get 15 grand to make something that's really important to you is when you write out the first draft, you realise you've written your emotional story of, you have to give me this money. And then the second draft, you begin to say what the artwork is. Then by the third draft, you're going, and the public really need this. So it's about those iterations of, because we're all emotional beings, you know. It's so before we get to these, you know, the big year writing forms, which I want to call hideous, but they are liberating in the long run, they test your ideas. So it's just like a sketchbook does. If you're running through a sketchbook and you're writing stuff and you're going, oh, that page is awful, this one works, this one works. It's the same thing as putting a whole research project together. It tests what really works.
I suppose it's creating your own brief.
Yeah. Yeah.
Good. This has been super interesting, and I can feel everybody's gripped by all of this. This is really interesting stuff. We've got time for one really quick question, if anybody wants to do one quick one. Otherwise, I think we'd better let you go on your way to other things you've probably got at 2 o'clock. Thank you, everybody, for coming. Thank you to Clare.
Thank you.